Korean words in Academy of London. I was in active duty corporal when I, before I was just practicing for 2 years. It was during the Korean conflict. I was drafted in Germany. The first of March in 1952, and I got out on the 3rd of March in 1954. I was out on the campus. I worked at Kansas in Murray for 47 and a half years. High school was my top. Working in the shop, I went to five different schools for every year for the training. The new vehicles, before they came out, so they'd get some changes and went to school for a couple of years. But, yeah, I was going to go to drinking school for a while, until I got a Dear John letter. She made somebody else. Just kind of shrugged it off. I married Phil Skibbs in 1954 after I got out of service. We'd gone to the same church for my wives. So we met the church. We didn't have anything to do with God. We've been married 60 years, working on 61. So I was 52. I was 29. Yes, I think I did my little call to the boat. If you don't, I have to go spend my 2 years and get it over. The only difference is some of us guys who were back at the same time I was, the military seemed to put them in the Marines. I was working. I was working full time at Korean Veteran Peter at the time. So really didn't exactly know because I never had the chance to talk to him about it. About 3 weeks. I got my mother's letter drafted and they said they'd pick me up on the certain day at the certain time. Well, I'm going to have to go to the Army. We had moved to Dorset, the Mary Hotel. And they took us up. And they took a group of the Hawkeye State bus, took us to Waterloo, and then we got on a different bus and went to Des Moines. And they swore everybody in down there. There was half a dozen test folks came from all over the state. And they were sworn in. And I'm not sure everybody else came. And they had a special service to swear us in. Load up on buses and go again to Camp Carbon, Missouri, where they had all the veterans swearing all the uniforms and military gear. Get everybody fit and ready to go and take them to where they were going to have bases. Then they shipped the 5 different directions. Some of them went east, some of them went. My group went to Fort Riley, Kansas, down there in Manhattan, Kansas. Started in basic. The basic cycle level was a 12-week cycle at that time. It was 12 weeks. We were in the ninth week, we were in the next week, we were going on big work, and it came up. There was some band trial, and I played French when I was in high school. So I said, I want to try out to the band. So I tried out, and the band said, we had a new class starting on Monday. And this was on Friday that I tried out, and they said, well, transferring you right out of basic over to the band school. So I was transferred out of basic, so I never finished the 12 weeks of basic training, but they transferred over to the band school, and that was 8 weeks. That was a four class camp. They let me know that I had passed, and they actually they were hearing to bring from the day and handing for a while. And one of the guys that I performed for was a nephew of the minister at Trinity Lutheran that was a Fitcher, Ed Fitcher, and he was a nephew of one of the guys conducted my trial. And I always liked music and all, so he played the Fitcher on sang in the groups when I was in school, and still sang in church choir when I was out of high school. So after we went through our school, went through that new class of band school for 8 weeks. 80% of that class was sent to Seattle Port of Education Band. We played for the ships that left out of Seattle to go to Japan, Alaska, and Korea, and one to Seattle, from Seattle Port, from Japan, Alaska, and Korea. Sometimes we had as many as four jobs during the week. I mean, we'd go down and the band would set up and we'd play for about half an hour while they finished. When they went out, they were already loaded. When we got there and we played and the ship left, and when I came in, they were already in at the dock and we set up and played while we were on the ship. Trying to keep up the attitude of those who were leaving and showing the ones that came back in where after we made it home. The people that got on and got off of the boats had no idea who they were. And one time we asked them, somebody was standing back, other people were standing in our area when we were playing for the boat, and somebody started hollering my name. I said, what? I looked around. There was a guy from Art Swenson who lived out in the western part of New Hampton. The boat's daughter, husband, was waiting on the ship. They were out there and said, when you're out there like that, you don't expect to see anybody from here. And here we were, and she asked, after we had done playing, and the ship left, we had a chance to get a quick cup of coffee and before we got off the bus and went back to the post. When you're that far away from the weekend, and would you expect to run into anybody from here? And after I got home, I found out I had played for a lot of people from this area when they came in from Seattle and had no idea from town that I played for when they left. And he said, I don't like the song you played. I said, why is that? He said, you played so long it's been good to know you. When they left, and our director always wanted us to play that song for them when they left. He said it hit me the wrong way. But I found out after it happened that I had played for quite a few people in the Northeast area that had come in through Seattle. One of them was a classmate of mine. I was in high school and he worked at the bakery here and he was drafted. He got to be a baker in the Army. And he came in coming back from Seattle. I didn't know he was coming. But since I talked to him later, I found out he was one of the guys that we played for him. He came in. So he said the world's a lot smaller than you think it is. Mm-hmm. Well, he said, oh, very nice guy. I started playing instrument in summer between fourth and fifth grade, and I played all during school. Well, still, I'm even close to the children who played. I had two older sisters who were in the band, and I got in, and then my younger sister got in, and I played also. My oldest sister graduated from high school, but now he's about 10 years old. So she was 18 years old. Now, on a normal day, we'd get up at like 6 o'clock. And we'd go to NASCAR for breakfast, back to the barracks, and we'd go. Band rehearsal, which we didn't have a job from 8 o'clock until 10. Then we got individual group rehearsals. And in the afternoon, we could play some sports and that kind of thing. Keep our kids. We could have as many as 4 jobs a week. Maybe just one. We never knew. But we know a couple days at a time when he's coming in. We know what, like I said, a couple days ahead was whether we had a job or not. Like if we were going to be just in a parade or something that day, we'd play a lot of march music. Then if we had some of the parades, you'd march and you'd have to stop in a certain area and play certain special songs for you, something that way. We'd practice for another thing. Otherwise, nothing really special. Our band, they usually have a teeth there. In the spring, the band marched in the parade again. But we kept doing it. They wanted the military officers to put together a dance band so we could play at the service club on the Wednesday night. So we put together a band, and all the drummers in the band at that time were 20 years and they had been in service, and they said, we're not messing around, we're more dancing. So I ended up playing drums in the dance band. My friend took it. And we put together a band and we played couple different nights at the service club. It was every Wednesday night we had to play there. And some of the military guys from the NCO club wanted to know if we could play for some dances for them. And we ended up we played Wednesday night at the Service Club, and then we played at the MTO Club Friday, Saturday, and Sunday nights, and we got paid by the MTO Club. And when I got out of service, the military paid for a corporal was $88 a year. So I'm different now, Mr. McMahon. But playing in the band, those of us who were in the band, we got paid, we were making more money playing in the band than the government was paying us. Playing the band, spend four nights a week. Bowling two nights a week, we passed away. Took my bowling ball along to me. They had a bowling alley on the post. Bowling league, we had a green money. 6 nights, started on the group, yes. Played basketball, we played baseball. I was just about like having a good job. Well, I want to tell you, when I first got there, about 2 weeks I've been there. And I can remember coming back from training for a trip to direct, and I had a note on the bulletin board. I was supposed to call from the strike. And I said, what did I do wrong now? So I called him, and I found out he was a retired from the military, had recently was from the Hampton, had been a classmate of my mother's in school, and he said he was still getting the New Hampton paper, and he saw where I had been sent to the band in Seattle, and he said, you remember your second grade teacher? I said, yes. And he said, in 2 weeks, we're going over the mountains to Sharon, Washington, which is about 125 miles east of Seattle, to visit her. She's remarried and lives out here, and she and her husband have an apple orchard. They grow the great big delicious ones that are about this big. So I said, well, if I don't have a job that day, I could go to members of the band, carry the Class A pass, and talk about all kinds of things. We didn't have to worry about getting a pass. Anyway, I called him on the Friday before and told him he didn't have the job lined up for that day. So I could go, and he said, good, I'll pick you up at 4 o'clock in the morning. So he was there, and we went over and drove over the mountains. It was about between 10:30 and 11 o'clock, and we got to the homes, had lunch. He said, the apples that they sold had to be perfectly red. If they had a green streak on them, they didn't sell. So he said, we don't even pick those. We just pick the red ones. And then when it gets time, they said, we shake the trees and feed those apples to the pigs. I said, well, it wouldn't stop you from eating one. He said, I know. He said, we eat a lot of nuts out here. They gave me two big grocery sacks full of apples, and I took them out to the post. The band I played in varied from about 28 to 32 people. Some were leaving, some were moving to come in. At that time, there were once a week serving us. We only made 2 sea rations at the muster. And whatever came up, they were going to have sea rations. We had enough. And the band that lived on the coast, the rest of them were married and lived in Seattle, residential areas, but their wives would just come in during the day and then go home at night. So we had two lessons we think we would be apples, which is the nearby serpent. Well, we had cans of beans. They had some bright meat that was in a can, and they wound it up. And we actually didn't have much to do with the people in Seattle. No one in the hotel, so we were there all the time. But, Spokane is a big army base there. So there's a lot of military around there. And Navy, there's a lot of Navy and Army boats. Seattle was pretty much had a lot of rain. Sometimes it would rain after the night. In the morning, it would clear up and be a beautiful day. One winter, it snowed about 8 inches during one night. In Seattle, and it tied that city up, but you wouldn't believe it. It was very, very sudden. They didn't have a snug house. Even on our army post, all they had was a road grader that they used to clean the roads off in hopes that people could get around the city. The same to extension. The city has expanded quite a bit too. And they have resting up on the top yet. That wasn't very long. We would spend, we're outside on the army post, which is in any gate you want to run out of. From the army post we were in on both of those areas, we were down a little point off the wind. But it never needed to have any problems with somebody in Seattle at all. We ran to get about 3,000 people, and then still about the same. It's like 75,000. Oh, that's all of members of the band. They did things. One of them members was Neil. He's from Clarksville. And he ended up being the postmaster in Clarksville after he got out of service. And one of his daughters was the postmaster here in New Hampton for 2 years before she left. She went to Colorado and postal department. Neil Bailey, he's still alive, but he's had some tough problems in the last few years. That's kind of hard to say. Everything was about the same. All I was in that situation out there was just about like being home. Or usually weekly. The time that I had been doing during the day. In my particular family, without my own son and four sisters, I didn't go home. I was one of the fortunate few. I spent my entire time in the United States, not in a battle, and I've been from 52 to 54. So that was a few of older. When I first got out there was some of life that were being transferred and sent overseas. Commander was a warrant officer, and he was sent over. three leaders in charge of this band, and we had two of them, but he was sent over, and the band members were sent over. And they, sometimes they came back before the 20-year men in service, like, became members of our band. He said, well, it was announcement on TV that they had the signing of the drums. It was good, they didn't have to worry about going overseas anymore. But some of them still went afterwards. He was a mechanic and had an independent shop, and I started working with him in the shop the summer between 7th and 8th grade. And I worked with him Saturdays and summers all during school. And after I got out of high school, I went to work with him. And he was part of the work. Some of them were originally Willadsen and Peter. When he passed away, Bill Kruger took it over and he ran it. And when he passed away, the parchman and I took it over and ran it for about 3 years. And then when the second parchman that I was parking with got sick and passed away, Frank Kraft bought his share. And then that's where Captain KW Morgan took Kraft and Willadsen. We were together for about 5 years. I worked there 47 and a half years. After I turned 65, I sold my share to Frank Kraft, and I just worked there. When I turned 65, I'm still working. I didn't quit work at the garage until I was 76 years old. 2008, it was pretty much the same. Then I went around this area to a fellow named Keith Conklin. Taught music in schools. He taught in Fredericksburg, he taught in Nashville, taught in Tri-City, and Osage. And when I got out of service, he wasn't teaching anymore. And he put together a group with other booster boys. He had musicians from all the different towns of where he had taught. And some from the Hampton who played in this band. And we put on programs in the summer. We do our traveling. We had a good time together. That way, but I still went back to work at the garage when I went back home. Played baseball with the Manhattan Town team. Got married. I smoked. I'm out working at the garage, working on trucks and stuff. The later years got to people with cars didn't want anybody smoking in their vehicles. So I ended up mainly with just two. I smoked cigars mainly. And I ended up with two instead of more than I was smoking. And when I quit work, I quit. Like I said, we've been to the same church for years and had sung in the choir together at the church all the time. After we got married, we sang for the wedding, which technology astounded. The wedding music, beyond these days, is not our common music. And that was one of the new things that came here for the funeral. But I always sang, we watched the minister's gospel hour every Saturday. And that time, and I was down in two different stations. There was one from 5 to 6, and another from 5:30 to 6:30, and 6:15. Here's some good music, good singers, still singing. When they had the little day of prayer, around about 3 weeks later, I can all sign a song for service. I'm getting my prayer, thank you. Do a lot of volunteer work nonsense. My wife is in charge of the volunteers at the cultural center. I don't know if any of you have ever been down at the cultural center. Little Liberty. I'm one of the 18 or 19 people that are volunteers. Once a month, sometimes twice a month. And whenever churches are assigned about 4 different months of the year, at the Cold Pantry, when our church is assigned, which is this month, and this month is one, I usually work there every year. Work at the food pantry for 9 to 10 minutes. My mother was, we went to a congregational church. My mother was, my dad was working, trying to get back that thing. Put the food on the table, and you know, and sometimes we worked on Sunday. The people who couldn't buy up a vehicle during the week, and we worked on Sunday for them. Back then, they feed the family first. We always took care of our family first, too. My wife and I had 8 children, and now our family total is 52. 19 grandkids and 23 babies. And the youngest baby is just 6 months old on Monday. The youngest brother's son is more so. They're spread out now, but 2 of the daughters live in Texas, 1 here in town. We have 8 children and 5 boys. And 3 girls. And the oldest and youngest daughter lived in Tyler, Texas. And the only one who's ever been married, so they don't have any children. Couple of guys been married twice. Very small. Well, like I said, when I got out in Seattle and come to strike, originally from New Hampshire. I don't know if you know any of the Sheehys in town. Gerald Sheehy, the mother, was a Clinton Strike sister. And he worked at Michaels and Morris for years. We called him Gerald anyway. So I said the world was quite small. I bowl a lot over the years. I bowl last night. Indeed. My team is one of the seasons in first. My team is one of the first third and third this year. So we're in playoffs. My bowling when I was in my 50s. I averaged over 200 for over 12 years. And now my head is down to 150. After I turned 75, the head starts going down a little bit every year. And so the ball won't even open for 10 years. It's not there anymore. It's a lot more physical. The part of the world where we're having fighting is in the Middle East. People there have been fighting since day one against each other, and all because of religion. And it's still what they're fighting about. I don't know if that will ever be settled. I don't know if that's actually, people don't want to go to war, and I don't believe. But if this comes to a conflict like the Second World War was, people will go and defend the United States. It's a complete different ballgame after the big bomb dropped in the game. We had conflicts like we had before. None of my children is very much older than grandchildren and more like great grandchildren. You don't want to look that kind of stuff on anybody.